Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. This is really a special evening for us. We have two of my favorite people on the dais. So thank you for being here, Mr. Bajaj. It's also special because I see very many new faces who I admire and I have admired for many years. So thank you all for being here. And may I make a small request? If you all could please switch off your phones before we have the program start, that would be very, very helpful. And after the program, if you all would join us for a cup of tea at the back, that would be wonderful. So without any further ado, Mr. Bajaj, thank you for being here. Mr. Das,
thank you,
over
thank
to you.
Thank you, Kiran. It's your experience for both of us, I'm sure.
I fully agree.
We haven't.
I don't know what I'm doing here.
We haven't been together on a platform together for a long time, though our association goes back to 1976, when he, Mr. Bajaj, appeared on the radar screen of an industry association which I was associated with for a long time. And for him, as for me, it has been a lifetime involvement with that association. This is, Kiran has got a CEO series, and this is supposed to be part of the CEO series, but Mr. Bajaj is not a CEO. And he was a CEO, but he is a business leader. He continues to be on the Prime Minister's Council for Industry. Why, I don't know.
Nor do I.
He is.
I'm agreeing with him on everything.
He's been a member of parliament for 4 years in the Rajya Sabha, and we will come to that in a while. Though he is hugely individualistic, it is amazing that he is deeply committed to and involved in institutions, and institutions which he's involved with. He has been involved with for a very long time, and it's just not CII, it is SIAM, which is the Automotive Association, it's the Indian School of Business, which he's been a founder director of, and other such institutions. He is a very significant philanthropist through
nobody
the General
Nobody Bajaj ever heard
Foundation.
Of this.
Nobody ever heard of this, so we'll, you know. Businessmen actually have a bad image, so nobody thinks that there are any good businessmen.
But we are in good
around.
Company because right. politicians also have a bad image.
That's right. So, but philanthropy is something we will come to, and what he does and how he does it. If you remember, those of you who are of that age, there was something called the Bombay Club, and there was an unappointed or self-appointed president of the Bombay Club.
One member club.
Well, no, there was Harishankar Singhania.
No, there were 12, they all disappeared. Keshav Mahendra, not 12, 14 of them, all disappeared, leaving me as the president.
President and sole member of the Bombay Club, which was all about, the perception was, protection for Indian industry and keep foreign investment out. And that brings me to the next thought, that as I see him, as I perceive him, one other aspect of him, he's a very strong nationalist. He's a strong Indiaphile. But at the same time, this is the man who brought the World Economic Forum into India. He connected us to the World Economic Forum. He's been associated with them forever. He is the only Indian who sits on the World Economic Forum Foundation Board. So he is accepted also by the international community.
No, Mukesh Ambani also, we are two of them on the foundation board.
On the foundation, okay. I stand corrected. You're in good company.
Very good company.
He's also, by the way, both of them, this I know, are on the International Advisory Council of Brookings Institution.
Only two of us again.
Only two of us again. That's right.
Only difference is I attend all meetings, he does not. Right. He pays them instead.
He's a CEO. You see, he has to do some work.
CEO of what?
Of his group.
Oh.
He has to run his companies, he has to make money.
That he makes a lot of.
As you gathered, he's outspoken. He's very, very outspoken. Hmm? Sometimes when he is outspoken, the one-sided conversation can go on for a long time.
That's why they didn't allow me to speak.
And but you know, when I worked with him in the CII, he was fiercely loyal to CII, as he still is, but he was fiercely critical if we put a foot wrong and if we did something which didn't stand up to his scrutiny and public scrutiny. The other person who was like a chief internal auditor with you is also in the room, Jamshed Irani, because he was very tough on us. And Jamshed, it's good to see you here. The last point I want to make about him is his integrity, which is something which a lot of people find as a disappearing value in this country. So it's good to have somebody like you who speaks his mind, who is consistent in what he says, and who believes in leadership with values. Now, the first part of this conversation is between the two of us, and then I'm going to throw it open quickly to you all. I'm going to ask the first question, which is, I'll take you back to your running business days, CEO days, where these long lines of people waiting for Bajaj scooters. The Bajaj name was spreading through not only India, but Indonesia and all of that, you know. The scooter and the two-wheeler was known as Bajaj. You never borrowed, the company never borrowed any money, I'm told. The Bajaj Auto has no debt. Now, how can you run business without borrowing money from banks and not paying them back? What kind of a businessman were you? What kind of a businessman are you?
In Pune, we have six companies. I live in Pune, not in a big city like Mumbai where all the big people live. I don't even live in Pune. I live 19 kilometers from Pune in a village called Akurdi where we have our corporate office. And I've lived there. I'm a Bombaywala, but did my economics honors from St. Stephen's College, Delhi. But I didn't want to be an absentee landlord, so I shifted to Pune in 65 and Akurdi, and have been there since. My three children have been technically born there, lived there, et cetera, till my daughter got married. Of these six companies, one is a consumer finance company called Bajaj Finance Limited. Being a consumer finance company, obviously, if it has to earn any return on its assets and especially on equity, it has to leverage that equity, has to borrow, and it does borrow from the beginning. 25-year-old company. It's a small consumer finance company, but Touchwood doing very well, good profits and all that. I don't know whether we'll get it or not, probably not, but that is a company which has applied now for a banking license, one of those 26 companies. The other five, the names are not material, Bajaj Auto, Bajaj Holding, Bajaj FinServ, not only Bajaj Auto, all these things, and the two insurance companies. All five are zero debt companies. For the last 30 years, the insurance company started only 11 years ago, so from that day, they've never had debt. Bajaj Auto had debt over 30 years ago. So, I mean, Tarun is asking very politely, my others are asking, are you a businessman?
Yes.
You went to Harvard Business School? Yes, I did make that mistake. Didn't they teach you that you have to leverage your equity? I said, they taught me many things, but most of them I do not follow. And even here, bankers, you know, when you don't need a loan, bankers come to you. We know that story. When you need them, they're not available. So, chairman of banks, chairman of state banks, chairman of various banks from time to time to me and my family, why aren't you doing this? You can have a $1 billion project here, $2 billion, because even say about 7-8 years ago, not today, my cash and cash equivalent is about 50,000 crores of rupees, of which 30,000 crores is with, sorry, crores, rupees, I'm not converting into dollars and millions. Of that, 30,000 crores is about 28,000 crores with the insurance companies, which is regulated by IRDA, but within that, we can do, we invest as we like, we have our investment team. And the, about another 30,000 crores is our manufacturing and holding companies, where we can do exactly what we please as far as we are trying to be fair to the shareholder. And so with this kind of money, and even one-to-one, you can have how much debt, you can do lots of things. So and I, now this looks a little show-offish, but the aim is not that. With him sitting here, I can't afford to do that, and his wife, Ranjana, sitting there, she'll shout from there if I even try to show up. But what I tell people is, why do you want us to leverage? Why do you want us to expand? I may or may not like it, some of you may not like it, but most of those who are doing it are well-wishers who want your bottom line to be higher and the market cap to be higher. In a company, four things people look at. Top line, assets, market cap, and bottom line. Asset, you shouldn't even look at that. Very high assets, no profit, the company will go to bankruptcy. That company is no good. Yes, look at top line, because ultimately without the top line, you can't have a bottom line, but you must have a top line only if it's profitable. So the two major things, according to me, in a company, whether public sector or private sector, if it's listed on the stock exchange or even otherwise, is market cap and profits, and they are linked to each other. And I said, for last 30 years, last 20 years, last 10 years, last 5 years, entire private sector in India, all sizes, especially, even otherwise, especially if you take manufacturing, which is most of the companies, we have been always in the top 10. Private sector manufacturing. If you take all companies, you will have those four, TCS and Wipro and Infosys, Cognizant, those four IT companies. So I said, if I'm in the top 10 out of thousands of companies, with my top line and, sorry, with my bottom line and market cap, and I sleep well. Now, that names I can't take. Many of you know those names as well as I do, who don't sleep well. They come out in the public and appear very confident, but they have 20, 40, 60, 80,000 crores worth of debt. And barring two very big houses, who are okay. But I'll mention Mukesh Ambani. He has crazy debt, but that amount he has on his balance sheet on the asset side free, apart from the profit he makes. Good, bad, indifferent, that's not the issue. But there's no risk there. Similarly, I would say Tata's, huge debt. Nobody knows it better than Jamshed Adani, especially the Corus and the Jaguar Land Rover deal, forget the Tetley and all, Tata Motors and Tata Steel. Huge debt. But you have, apart from other things, you have Tata Sons and TCS. But the others, that's the answer. What for? God was great, if I can be old-fashioned enough to say that. But I'm very old-fashioned. If taking name of God is old-fashioned, I'm bloody old-fashioned. Sorry to use that word. God has been great to us, which means I and my team and my family have been very lucky, and I'm not a modest man, as he will tell you. And we did some things right. And scooter industry, two-wheeler industry, which now my son makes motorcycles, does not make scooters, that's another story, was a controlled industry till the liberalization started. The entire industry was controlled till 91, and scooters had price control, and this control, and that control, because there was a 10-year delivery period. Anyway, so as you said, I'll go on, so you better ask another question.
Well, since you mentioned your son.
Which one? I got two.
The elder one.
Elder one, Rajiv, okay.
Elder one because he's running Bajaj Auto.
Absolutely. The younger one runs all the other financial services companies. Yeah. Sanjeev, Rajiv runs Bajaj Auto.
But
he's the MD and CEO.
In a way, in the public eye, Bajaj Auto is the flagship company.
It is.
Of the group.
No doubt. Market cap is the highest.
So, when is it that you decided and you thought about handing over to him as the CEO, and what is the process? Did it take you a long time to hand over? How did it happen? Can you share with us? Because this is an important transition from father to son.
No, it's an important transition, and I think it's a very good question, and I'm happy that you asked it. I have to give out some secrets to answer that question honestly. I'm 75 years old. I feel I'm 55, but I'm 75 years old. My elder son is 46, the younger one is 43. They have separate companies to manage now. They don't listen to me. But they are very good, otherwise they wouldn't be there because the shareholding is with me, not with them. They can't sack me, I can sack them. But I can't interfere. They are the types who will say, you looked after it for 40 years, you still want to look after it, Papa? Thank you very much, we are doing something else. They are that type. And I'm delighted that they are that type. So, lots of people want to retire. As I said, I joined the company in January 65. Today I'm 75 years old. So it was around 1995, which is about what, 17 years ago, 18 years ago, when I was probably just under 60 years old. I said, whole world talks of succession planning, whole world talks of handing over. Mr. Bajaj, when are you going to do that? And I went, like everybody else, you're thinking over. So I won't talk about Sanjeev, then that followed. There's another story there. But Rajiv was the elder one, and he turned out to be in the group, not 3 years ahead of Sanjeev. He's 46, I repeat, Sanjeev is 43, but 7 years ahead. The reason being, to put it briefly, both did exactly the same thing with a 3 year gap, bachelor's of engineering, mechanical, first class distinction, master's of manufacturing systems engineering, Warwick, Kumar Bhattacharya, he knows very well, Professor Bhattacharya, he's now Lord Bhattacharya, distinction. And then the difference started. Rajiv started working. Sanjeev said, I want to do my MBA. So he worked for 2 more years because of the age thing. And then he went and did, like I did, his Harvard MBA. So 2 years of additional training, 2 years of Harvard MBA. So those were very useful years, hopefully, for him. Though my elder son says, MBA is a waste of time. He said it publicly. Fine. I mean, there are tens of thousands of MBAs in the world, but so what? That's his view. He's entitled to his view. I and my younger son and many others don't agree with that view. So there are 7 year gaps. We'll not talk about Sanjeev. The question is about Rajiv. I think I started very gradually. He joined the company in 1990 after his master's. Rajiv gradually started delegating. He was very interested in manufacturing and R&D and all that. He was on the shop floor, did great things. There are many other things I can't go into the details. John Wallace and all. That will take too long. This will have to be a 4 hour session, and they'll not really go home, but they'll want dinner and drinks and all that in between. So, then he got him in and started taking, so first 7 years, 7, 8 years till 97, he was on the shop floor. I didn't even know what he was doing. I used to get very good report. No decision making at the top level or nothing like that. Then that started, I think from very broadly, from 2000, he started taking over. So I said, I've started delegating. The formal date was 2005, 1st April, because I was till then chairman and MD of Bajaj Auto, and he was on the board for some time. And from 1st April 2005, he became the MD, and I remained only the non-executive chairman. So when really 2000, I really started delegating. Formally, it got completed in 2005, but from 2000, 2001, he stopped, you know, listening to me kind of thing. So that's the full delegation. Even a little before that, the guy called Tarun Das. Somebody went to talk to him and said, Rahul Bajaj is delegated to his son. Say, what nonsense, sir. He'll never delegate to nobody. He even signs 10 rupee checks in his company. Now, this was thousands of crore company making thousands of crore profit. But that was the reputation. Right or wrong, workaholic. Nobody delegates till he's thrown out. And here you are the owner. You are supposedly, I'm not. You are supposedly aggressive. I'm not, but supposedly confident in yourself. You will delegate to your son? You must be out of your mind. I do seriously believe whatever little I may have achieved during my business career, the way I handed over to first Rajiv and then the all financials to the sons is not, okay, I'll come to that, is not nepotism. If they were not doing a job as good or better than me, they would not be in that position. They know that, public knows that. Public believes it or not, it's the public's problem, not my problem. If I even give you a secret, Bajaj family, self and my children, everybody included, 98% of our wealth, not that it's much, but whatever it is equity of Bajaj Group Company. Stupid. All in one basket, no diversification? Yes. There's enough diversification because we have Mukund Steel, we have Bajaj Articles, we have these six companies in Pune, all in different businesses, there is enough diversification. But if somebody says there's not enough diversification because it's Bajaj Group, accept it. 97 or 98% is there. What, why am I saying that? The company don't do well, the market cap goes down, we disappear. Our reputation and our wealth is built, apart from my legacy of my grandfather, who was considered the fifth son of Mahatma Gandhi, Jamnalal Bajaj, we have no time to go into that, is built on the success of the Bajaj Group Company. And I shouldn't say that, but we are not my grandfather Bajaj, we are normal businessmen. But it, what he mentioned, wrongly maybe, the question of integrity. It's a question of how you run your company. You go to the temple every day, or every night, or every morning, and the rest of 10 hours a day, we know what you do. You generate a lot of black money, partly to give it to the politicians, and now you'll do it, elections coming, state and parliament. What kind of temple doing this? Similarly, 2% CSR, that's a separate issue, if at all, we'll come to that later. You do 2% CSR, my, he's like a very close to me, Rajesh Pilot's son Sachin was doing it, he's a great guy, great guy. But he says, that will be your best investment. I said, it's not his fault, it's the government, in the parliament. Don't mandate my generosity and my largesse. And anything which I'm required to do in terms of spending for CSR or charity or donation, whatever, however you define it, some people define it differently, by force is never a good investment. And you say it's the best investment for a company. Sorry, and I'm going to tell that to him if I get a chance tomorrow in the CII meeting where he's coming. You mean it well, Mr. Sachin. You mean very well. But business, what is the best investment of a business? We know a little bit more than you know, for no fault of yours. Maybe you know politics a little bit more than us. It's not the best investment. But that apart, that's another story. So, where was I? What was
succession, Rajiv? Huh. Worked out well?
So I think it's worked out extremely well, because today I think for the last 10 years, I think he's running a company much better than I would have run at my age. But even age-wise, okay. Anybody will say, if I say he's good, haha. And actually the father says that about his son. It's normal. But he and I disagree on so many things. So, and that's why I think he's great. If anybody agrees with me, he'll take me to the dogs. You don't want chamchas there, yaar. And I'll give two examples. He's doing so well, obviously, on 95% of things, I agree with him. Just one or two, and I'll give one only, because it'll take too much time. The basic thing where I disagree with him, and I told him even 2 days ago, I disagree with you. Yeah, I know. His decision to stop manufacturing scooters, which we made a million a year, we were king the road, it was Bajaj, Hamara Bajaj, everything under the sun, and going to motorcycles, rightly making motorcycles in the year 2000 when the Indian scooter market shifted to the motorcycle market. Hero Honda, that time now Hero Motors, was only making motorcycles. They were very lucky to that extent. It's a very good, very well-managed company. I call Brijman Lal Ji Munal, they're celebrating his 90th birthday or something, sorry. I call him my guru. And fact that he converted us from a scooter to a motorcycle company with his team was excellent. But who told you to stop making scooters? You give space to Hero, you give space to Honda, you give space to TVS and everybody else under the sun. And now for the last 3 years, scooter demand is increasing, motorcycle is flat. It's now 25 to 30% of the total two-wheeler market. Focus, it has to be focused. I listen, your father focused for 40 years on two-wheelers, three-wheelers. What will you focus? Everybody told me, make IT, do, get into IT, get into power projects, do this, do that. And my answer was the same as for leveraging. Why the hell should I do everything under the sun when I can sleep well with just this and beating? Every day I used to read 20, 30 groups. Investment of 3,000 crores, 5,000 crores. Where did the investment go? Either they didn't make it, they were bluffing, all my friends. Or it went down the drain, but didn't show in their market cap and their bottom line. We never made those kind of investment. So he said, focus. I said, don't agree. If you want to focus, you know, we make 7, 8 models of a motorcycle. Why don't you make only one, Pulsar 180? Focus. Why do you make three-wheelers? But that's a cash cow. Now, why are you making this not car, but quadricycle? Everybody shouting away, including his group. The quadricycle, the RE60. So I'm disagreeing with him there. He said, focus, focus. But I think the real thing is, he wants to make a scooter which will be a successful scooter, which will sell well and at a profit. Today, according to him, and he's not right, he's not wrong, most scooter manufacturers are not making good profit. If I may say so, Bajaj Auto's EBITDA, 20%. EBITDA is 20%. Is the highest in the automotive sector, two-wheelers and four-wheelers, in the world, not India. Toyota makes 6%. The best after us in India is Hero, 13, 14%. Not easy. But yes, market share, domestic. Export, we are by far the best in the two-wheeler, by far. We export 6,000-7,000 crores worth, 35% of our production, over 50% of our three-wheelers. Nobody else does anywhere near that in two-wheeler industry. Exports, profits. But domestic market share, we are behind, well behind Hero. My friend Pawan Munjal, even leaving Honda, is still doing very well, and Honda by itself is doing very well. So that's where we have to now come up and increase our market share.
Let's turn to politics.
What's that? Well, no, oh, politics. Oh.
I don't know how you became a member of parliament.
I also don't know.
Did you buy your way in? Did you have it handed to you on a platter, a membership of the Rajya Sabha? Your family been very connected to political leadership in this country.
No, my grandfather was a member of the working party, fought for freedom. So, my grandfather, grandmother, father, mother, uncle, all were in British jails, 42 to 46, etc. And my father was a three-term member of Lok Sabha from our hometown in Vardha. Hometown Vardha near Nagpur in Vidarbha.
There was something in your DNA. You wanted to be, you know, involved in some way in politics, and you took the Rajya Sabha route into the parliament. You were there for 4 years because you came into somebody's seat. Which
Pramod Mahajan seat.
Pramod Mahajan.
The 6 year term in Rajya Sabha.
So you did the balance 4 years. So did you? Was it satisfying? Did you contribute? Did you make a difference to the state of the nation? When did you finish as Rajya Sabha member?
2010, July.
2010. And I suppose we, that's the time when we started declining, isn't it?
Of course.
So.
Oh, yes, a question puchega to kya jawab milega?
So tell us about those 4 years in politics.
I didn't want to get into politics, depending on how you define politics. But like many of us, I'm a very aware citizen. Want to get very involved in what's happening in the country, not only in my company. In the last 10 years, I'm doing that. Companies are not, I'm not allowed to look into my company. Chairman, yes. Board level, yes. Major decisions, but nothing day to day. And because of family background, the Congress Party, I'll give the name, Shivraj Patil, and many others wanted me to come into parliament. My father was three-term member, then he passed away long ago. So because of that, and he was always a Congress MP. And I said, listen, I can't. If I come, I'll come seriously, and I won't take names. You check the other big industrialists in parliament in the last 30 years, who has attended it regularly? Nobody, including the present ones, both of whom I know very well. They come for a particular purpose. They tell me, you are mad. We can't hear. La, la, la. Some of them have paid 40, 45 crores to come there. I can't prove it. If you ask anybody in the parliament, ask the major political party, two major parties, one Devagaura's party, one even, but that's another story. But what for? 40 crores to come into anywhere? To give 5 rupees would be an insult. Insult. You don't buy a woman and you don't buy a seat in parliament. You read in the papers, 80 crore seats are being sold. The fellows who sell it, the leaders of those parties are crooks, and the fellows who buy it are equal big crooks. That's another story. I did spend 300 rupees when my election was announced in Bombay Vidhan Sabha. I distributed to the MLAs, not paid us, which normally Maharashtra does. I distributed purposely laddus, bundi ka laddu, Rajasthan, you see, though I'm a Maharashtrian de facto. So that cost me 300-400 crore rupees, and that's the only money I spent. Let Sharad Pawar, who brought me, or anybody else say that anybody got a penny from me, not only for coming into Raj Sabha, or for any quid pro quo in the last 30 years. Not a single cash money. I don't raise it. I don't have it. Nobody will believe it. I said, come and find out. Raid me and find out. I was raided in the past for different reasons, but that's another story. So that can't be proven whether I have black money or not. But what is relatively easy to prove is I don't give any. Because first, I'm known to be very conjuice.
Yes.
How readily they came.
Yes.
And even Kalyaniji, who's there regularly in the central hall of Raj Sabha, knows that all the MPs feed me. I hardly ever pay for all the food I had for all those years, and even now when I go there. Once an MP, always an MP, to some extent. So I used to say, I have to look after my companies. My children were very young. And then, again, it can be a long time. I remember in 2006, June, I get a call from London, Sharad Pawar. You want to come into Raj Sabha? I said, what's happened suddenly? He said, Praful Patel will tell you all the details. I'm on my way to the airport to go to New York. I'm very keen at that time to go to Raj Sabha. Praful Patel, and we are simple businessmen working here. He's a politician. Where was he? In fact, I got a message from him today. He's in Romania even now, abroad. I'm here. He was on an Alaskan cruise, if you please. I've also done that cruise before. But luckily, he was nearby. So he said, I made 15 calls. I got all 15 calls. He called up Advani ji. He called up Balasaheb Thakre. He called up all those parties. He explained to me briefly, Pramod Mahajan had died. And this is an NCP seat. And NCP Congress would have brought it. But it's a long story. For some reason, there's a problem. We can't bring it together with Congress. Congress is putting up a candidate. We have contacted everybody, BJP, Shiv Sena. That's all done. You have to do nothing. You have to file your form. When is the election? 6 days from now. You have to file in your assets and this and that. I said, you guys keep your assets abroad. You don't have to give any detail. My assets are all here. That will all become public. He said, yeah, yeah, yeah. When it's in the wealth tax return, how does it matter? So, etc. I said, let me check with my wife. I'll call you back. I called up. My wife said, kidhar fasne ko ja rahe ho? Kyun pagalpan kar rahe ho? But she knew for a long time, had been wanting. By that time, in fact, my son said, this is 2006, completely taken over. So I called up and said, okay, that is a long story, how I, BJP, Shiv Sena support. I thought courtesy demands, I talked to Advani ji, talked to Balasa. Advani ji, the moment I heard your name, it was not our seat anyway, it was NCP seat, and Congress seat. They would have got their man. Now, you're going to stand, you said, as an independent. I would rather have you, because all of them knew me very well. So, okay, there are then, and Sharad Pawar is a good friend. He is a good friend, very good friend for 40 years, 50 years. He said, talk to Sonia ji. She's not going to agree, but you should not spoil your relationship, Sonia ji. This is very good advice. Otherwise, you stand against a Congress candidate, you're not pleasing the person concerned. And so I rang her up and cut the story short. She says, Rahulji, I know the relationship with the Bajaj family and I would have done that, but it's 4 days too late. I've committed to a person, is a Nagpur fellow whom I know, this and this and this, and I can't do that. I says, up to you, Sonia ji, and all I'm saying is, I'm so and so age old. I am interested in coming to Raj Sabha to have some fun. I said that. And I don't know when I'll get a chance again. And at that time, I may be tottering like an old man. So I would like to come, and I would like to come with your good wishes. And Sonia ji, please check with Ahmed Patel and all that. And I rang him up also. Out of 288 MLAs in Maharashtra Assembly, I'm going to get 190. I got 194. And you are going to get the balance. It's known. The result is known in advance. Why do you put up your man to lose an election? She didn't agree. She said, so I said, OK, I'll come and see you after I get elected. I'll come and see you in Delhi. That's how I came into the, it's the first time I'm sharing all this with everybody, I think, that I came into the this thing. After that, I did meet her. She has been very gracious. There's been no problem at all, at least not from my side. And I'm sure she was not very happy at that time that I did stand. But and then I'll conclude this part of my reply by saying, those 4 years, I wouldn't have missed for anything. I learned a great deal. I enjoyed myself like mad. I had a great time. I was very regular. Ahmed Patel, ministers always used to say, Hari, tu to roj aata hai. Hari, you are even the afternoon here, and most people are not there, the regular MPs. I said, I'm unemployed. That's why I'm here all the time. And Central Hall, I used to be all the time. Kalyani will tell you, and many other journalists will tell you. And many of them I knew, many of them I didn't know. I made many new friends. But I realized that those I knew, including ministers, and they knew me, they knew my family background and everything, they were very good friends, but not Sharad Pawar, that's a different man, that's too close. Not half a dozen people like that. Many other good friends, but you became a different kind of friend. Now you are one of them. Whatever your Bajaj group may be, good, bad, indifferent, Jamnalal Bajaj and all that, you are an industrialist. Now you are a member of parliament. So, the amity, the affectionate thing changes, becomes deeper. Doesn't mean you agree with it. Where I used to sit in Raj Sabha, CPI, CPM, Samajwadi Party, Bahujan Samaj Party. I was, because I was independent, but brought in by Sharad Pawar and this, so I was the center in the Raj Sabha. That's the chairman, that is the vice president of India. This is the ruling party, treasury benches, and this is the opposition. If the total numbers one, are much more on one side, obviously they'll overflow to the other side. So I was, so the, there, this is this alley where you walk down straight in front of the chairman. So I told the secretary general, sahab, idhar rakho ye mere ko theek hai, but give me an aisle seat. Ye koi bar bar jayega, bahar jayega, mere ko disturb. They throughout I had an aisle seat. And the big bosses and all have to be in the front seat. So I was in the fourth or fifth seat, but I was nobody. And D. Raja, not D. Raja, but D. Raja of CPR. And Sitaram Yechuri, even Brinda Karat. But Brinda Karat said, how will you come? How does your Bajaj come here with BJP Shiv Sena support? I said, I come with Sharad Pawar. I've not come with their support, et cetera, et cetera. And though they are very good friends of mine. I didn't agree with D. Raja or Sen and many others of CPI, CPM, or even Bahujan Samaj Party, Samajwadi Party on economic matters. But ask any of them who are still there. Some of them are there, some of them are not there. We all became very good friends. In fact, they started saying, you are not an industrialist. I said, yeah, Jindi, but the industrialist, yeah, I'm not an industrialist. One day, and I used to speak. Of course, independent don't get too much time to speak. But as the chairman, deputy chairman used to say, Rehman Khan, who's now become a minister of minority affairs, and some other Korean who's now the deputy chairman. He said, have I ever stopped you? Said, if you talk sense, by and large, then they don't stop you. Once I said, for example, I didn't even realize, I said something like, I said, we need competition, we need competition. That the communists are not very impressed with that. And I said, monopoly is bad, monopoly is bad, that they agree. And then I just said, Monopoly is bad, but private monopoly, private sector monopoly is worse than public sector monopoly. After I sat down and there was a break, all of them came to me, congratulations. I said, what happened? You said private sector monopoly is worse than public sector. And I said, yeah, I mean that. And I told them why I said that. I said, you know that, I'm a 100% private sector man. Anyway, I'll go on. So I enjoyed, I learned a lot, I deepened my friendship. And you see, I don't know, sugar industry is a very political industry. Now, all of us read in the media what is happening, what is not happening. Cane price ka kya hai, sugar price ka kya hai. Rateem, Sonny is sitting here, her husband is very big in sugar in UP. He knows my nephew very well, who looks after independently my sugar industry. Well, not mine now, his sugar industry. But the kind of, I mean, ultimately after 2, 3, 4 months, if you are interested in that subject, you'll get all the details. You can read everything, you know. But for those few days, the kind of insight you get there, what's happening on the floor of the house, opposition saying what, this fellow is saying that, why is he saying this? All that kind of thing, you can't get if you are not inside. You know, you don't have time, they don't have time, and they will not even tell you that. So it was pretty good. And people would say, why have you come here? I said, listen, I would not have been able to come here. I can get a Lok Sabha ticket from almost any party today. And I'm not out of my mind at my age to fight a Lok Sabha seat, and who the hell will elect me? But that apart, Raj Sabha is very easy to get. Depending on the state, you need 40, 42 seats to get elected. Once the party leader tells you, stand, there are some other details there, but we'll not go into that. Then it's automatic, you have to do nothing. You have to do nothing except file your this thing. So everybody is dying to get into Raj Sabha. They'll give it to their members, no? The party members. Why will they give it to an independent? I only got it because Pramod Mahajan died. It was a NCP seat. It's a long story. I know the whole story. But they couldn't get the Congress together on that reason, as I said. So they had to take BJP Shiv Sena support. Now, BJP Shiv Sena support will not give. First, Sharad Pawar is a very, very close friend of mine. But he thought of me partly because a friend, partly he thought I was suitable. I would not put him down. And he had to find somebody acceptable to BJP and Shiv Sena. An NCP guy, then they would have said, why would we support you? It's your problem and Congress's problem, do what you like. So he would have had a problem. So he couldn't get too many names who are suitable, who are this, who are those. And as it turned out, I talked to Bala Sahib with that. I mean, I knew him from before, and Udhav and all that. I said, Udhav, ek paisa nahi milega tere ko mere se, ha? Bola, maloom hai yaar. So that's how I got elected, and Advaniji called me for dinner in his house, just one person. His whole family was there soon after that. But it was a great experience, Tarun.
Okay, I can go on for a long time with you, but I think I need to bring the audience into this. Quick questions around the room. Mic here, please. First I. Yes, madam. After this, lady in blue at the back.
Hi, I'm Victor Mallet from the Financial Times, based here in Delhi for about the last year or so. I just wondered if you said you were going to raise this, but you didn't quite have time to talk about it. If you think there's a rift between the wealthy, the rich of India, and the rest, and if so, you know, how does that manifest itself, and what can people like you do about it, if anything?
Can I add a supplement? Wealthy. There's a rift between the wealthy and the poor.
In India or the West, you said?
I'm thinking particularly of India, whether
India.
That's the case, and what you know, big business people can do about it.
And what can business do about it? And the question I had in mind was a little different, that you've been on both sides, in a way, because you've been in Rajya Sabha, so I say you've been on the other side. Business has a bad image in this country. Maybe business has a bad image everywhere.
Most places, but that's no consolation.
We're talking about India now.
Right.
Why and what can you do about it? Just to add.
It's another good question. Various ways to look at it. Shortage of time. The one way that I will look at it while answering the question. Globalization is here to stay. It's not going to go back, though after 2008, even in the West, there are a lot of people who criticize it. Fair trade under WTO, The Doha development round is going on from 2001. Failure now in Indonesia and Bali. There'll be the final ministerial after 13 years. Those who is in the developed world, that's my view, and I talked to the Pascal Lamy, the director general, etc., all the people, the trade representative of some countries, all these developed world people who used to preach us, free trade, good for you, good for you, good for everybody. Last few years I find they still say the same, the practice different. Shoe pinches, the shoe is on the other leg. So now I think they get protectionist. Yes, we were so protectionist and they were free. So overall they are still more free than us. But after 91, we have changed a great deal. But yes, our real estate, our financial services, some areas are still controlled. Insurance is 26, they wanted to go to 49. All that is happening, but otherwise, in some ways, we are much freer than China. You can't set up 100% owned auto industry in China. Here you can, any industry, you can set up 100% without FIBB approval. It's only that financial sector and real estate and all that where you, this thing. But as I understand, you can do work there much more easily. They don't have the hassles which we have here in our lovely democracy, which I love, but which we know it's our problem. So globalization is good for the world, according to me. One of its quite a few downsides are growing inequality among nations and within nations. It's important to note, barring some few, they're also changing, some few countries in southern, not South Africa, below the Middle East, below Sudan and all that, what's called Black Africa, but I don't want to use that word. Barring a few countries there, the poor have benefited by globalization. Even India, the poor has benefited. I've not heard anybody oppose that. The moment you talk to CPI, CPM, they'll say something else in addition. But inequality has increased. Now, if inequality increases, the guy who's here, how is he going to like the guy over there? India, it is our tolerance, this is our history of 5,000 years, it's our religion, and I don't know what else, that nothing bad is happening. We don't have terrorists here. We have terrorists coming from across the border, including last 2 days. Sorry to say, they shake hands in New York, and they do this here. As far as I'm concerned, as a civilian, the Prime Minister there has no, I met Nawaz Sharif 2-3 times. He doesn't run ISI, he doesn't run the army. Otherwise, how can you do this? Not today for so long. So that's another story. Inequality is no good. Two things. The rich, how do they behave? Do they behave? Why do you have bad name? Why do politicians have bad name? Not that politics is bad, according to me, not that business is bad, because you guys do the wrong thing. We raise black money, we give black money, we cheat, we don't treat the minority shareholders well, etc., etc. And politicians, I don't have to say anything. You know in the last 4 years what's happened. The 2Gs and the Colgates and what else. The reason for having a bad name all over the world, partly is the nature of the profession. You can't please everybody. But talking of India, it's because of the bad eggs. We keep telling the government, make laws for the good, 80%, 70%, 90%, I don't know what, and not for that 5-10 bad percent. Because those guys, even then, get free. So they give money. So they're not caught. If they are caught, they get free. And this fellow is like an idiot. My friend Jamshed Irani doesn't give money. So if he does the slightest mistake, he's now retired, thank God for him, he'll get caught. Then he doesn't know how to get out. Same here. So first is how you behave. You behave well, the bad image will reduce over a period of time. I say that in my speeches from time to time. The other thing is, what is the inclusive growth all about? To bring the poor up. You should not try to bring the rich down. I'm not saying that as a rich man. I don't mind if they go down. But it's not the right thing. It won't succeed. And then you'll have more black money. So bring the poor up. That's what inclusive growth is about. And that's what the debate between Amartya Sen and Gerard Reyes on the one hand, and Jagdish Bhagwati and Arvind Panagriya on the other hand is all about. You think Amartya Sen doesn't want growth? Of course he wants growth. I know him a little bit. He knows him well. You think Jagdish Bhagwati and Arvind Panagiriya are idiots? They don't want to look after the poor or education and health, which was talked about? Of course. It's a question of, partly I think it's a question of semantics and little priority. Growth, then government will get money, spend it for that. Jagdish Bhagwati. Amartya Sen, but if you don't educate them well, if you don't treat their health well, how the hell will you grow? Okay. So one can keep debating. The question in India is, and I mentioned it to the Prime Minister on 29 July in that meeting, I don't know whether I should have. I mentioned Bhagwati, I mentioned Amartya Sen in some context. I said I was against loan waiver. And the way you are doing the food security bill, the way you have done the MGNREGA, or not MGNREGA, but MNREGA. I didn't mean to say that. These are all well-intentioned policies, very inefficiently implemented and in a corrupt manner. I didn't say that. Rajiv Gandhi said, no 16 paisa in a rupee reaches the intended beneficiary. Today, I don't know, it may be 20, 25, 30. It's not 80. 80 would be excellent because some establishment cost will be there anyway. But not due to inefficiency and corruption.
You said business should behave well. I mean,
absolutely.
Anything specific? I mean, you mentioned about cheating, minority shareholders, corruption. Any other thoughts just to...
I think your conscience tells you what is ethical and what is not. As the chairman or the CEO of a company, any company, and I'm talking of listed companies, where you have shareholders, thousands of tens of thousands of shareholders, you know what is right, what is wrong. If you don't know, you should not be in that position. But I don't know if anybody who doesn't know. They know.
Okay, ma'am.
Sir, for the purpose of this question, I would like you to assume that you've got your banking license.
You've got your banking license.
You should presume that you've got your banking license.
Yeah, you can presume that you've
I
got
I wish
your...
I could.
Okay, so now, from your perspective, I would like to hear what are the various challenges the sector is facing, and what are your plans to address them? That's the first part of the question. And the second part of the question is that if you were like meeting the governor and the finance minister, what are the three, four things that you would request them to change in the current regulatory environment, you know, to facilitate growth in the banking sector?
Now let's combine the two questions.
So you're a banker now?
No, first I'm a...
You're a banker.
First I've applied. And then I'm a banker and... but what will you do now having got it? So that's the question. Yeah. And then I'm not only...
What are your priorities?
I'm also Chidambaram, because I'm finance ministry. And
what are you going to tell Raghuram, Rajan and Chidambaram?
My son, younger son Sanjeev, who's the one handling this with his team, he's the right one to answer that. But one of the major reasons for getting into banking, and it should not be that it's status symbol or something like that. Like 30 years ago, people started getting into computers as a status symbol. You don't have an IBM 1401? Oh, la la. That would be stupid. We've got 5-year, 10-year projection. For last 1 year, our people have worked on it. We have an NBFC, what I referred to earlier, Bajaj Finance Limited. That is a company which has applied for the license. They already have a lot of experience in that field, but we have a lot to learn. One of the reasons for going is, apart from the fact that can, you see, a bank gets you much lower cost capital because of depositors, current account, savings account, especially current account, than an NBFC, a non-banking finance company. The cost of capital is very high. So competition with banks is not proper, reasonable. Plus, it can have much bigger opportunity. And the danger is, what we don't know for sure, in the next few years, the government will start, due to the pressure from banks, public sector and private sector, because some of the, if I may say so, non-banking NBFCs like ours, they are doing very well. They will want us covered by the same conditions which banks are, but without the benefit of that deposit. I'll mention three conditions. CRR, SLR, credit reserve ratio, statutory liquidity ratio, and what's called priority sector lending. And you must have 25% of your branches in not BC cities, F cities, 10,000 and less population. Challenges are these three things. Apart from learning to run how to bank, it will take time, 2-3 years, it will take time to run a bank. But SLR, CRR increases your cost, and 25% in those cities with 10,000 and less population. So you have to work for it. There's no other answer. It's getting there, there are no guarantees you'll do well. It's a risk. If you don't have that 25% branches, there are penalties. In our forecasts, we have presumed we'll not be able to fully do that, and we have put the penalties in our P&L account, et cetera, et cetera. And so we are going ahead. If I was the Reserve Bank governor or the finance minister, first of all, I'll go and speak to Yashwant Sinha, my friend, who used to be known as Rahul Bajaj's finance minister, I'm joking a little bit, when he was the finance minister, and that was said by Manish Shankar here in the parliament. Yeah, Rahul Bajaj, because I had said something good about him. And he was opposition, he was BJP. And he's a friend of mine. I've not met him for ages. Most of my friends I don't meet for ages. So he's the chairman of the Standing Committee on Finance. You have read 4 days ago what the Standing Committee said. No large houses should be given a banking license. Pre-69, when you look at Indira Gandhi's nationalization, you are reversing one ideological battle. Second, they used to give money to their own companies. It will start again. And third, this inclusive growth, they will not do. These are three things they said. And then they said, in 1990 and 2001, private sector after nationalization. In these two periods, 1990, then 10 years, then 2001, after that nothing has happened. Say they gave 12, 14, 16 licenses, only 4 or 5 are aligned. Rest closed or merged with others. They said, see, 5, 6, 7 people got licenses. All are closed barring one. Yes Bank is the one, Rana Kapoor, which is on, and then a couple of others. Okay. But the joke is, in those two periods, no large houses got a license. So my answer is, that's why these guys closed down. They were not strong enough. They were very weak. Those individuals couldn't run a bank. Second, you say, I'll give money to my this thing. All I can say is, I won't. You are talking of before 69, times have changed. You have put in the regulation, you can't loan to your people, and then you control us. If you can't control us, it's your problem, not my problem. Your weaknesses, don't put the people at risk. They've said 500 crore capital should be increased to 1,000. I have no views on that. It suits me. So I have no problem there. And I will not, they say he will not do inclusive growth. Last point. First of all, how do you say I will not do inclusive growth? Mr. Yashwant Sinha, in your unanimous view of your standing committee, I'm told the Rahul Gandhi was not present, but they have said unanimous view, was always unanimous view of those present. And he didn't give a, no, and the other, he didn't give a vote of dissent. So you have to presume that Rahul Gandhi is supporting. Little different from being there and voting in favor, but So Yashwant Sinha, I will basically say, I'm supposed to have 25% branches in those 10,000 less cities. What's the average of your public sector banks? Below 20%, well below. In some banks, below 15%. In fact, I will say, you can't force me to have 25%. Get the existing guys to do. They got their real estate branches and all so-called low cost. We have very high cost. Tata's have applied. Birla's have applied. Anil Ambani's applied. Mukesh has not. Yeah. And when they reach what they reach, we will reach. But anyway, so I don't know, because of this, especially the standing committee thing, whether the government will change its mind or not, I can only hope not, because if I don't get it, fine, it's not an issue. But you have to get more and more branches. That's what Chidambaram has said. You want more competition. Some new branches will open in small places. What is the harm? Make sure they don't do it themselves. The only harm can be, which is there in every any company, that small depositor, his money will get lost. With the NPAs, with the public sector banks, the money is getting lost. If it's not getting lost, it's only because the taxpayer is making up by recapitalizing all the banks. So what the hell is happening? So I think this is the old socialism, which is coming back. That's one of the things I mentioned in Prime Minister's thing, which didn't make him happy. I said, sir, many of us believe, we were 15 of us there, including Mukesh Ambani and all. I said, many of us believe we are going back to the license permit Raj of pre-1991. You have been hearing about this. And I said that. I said, anyway.
You had a question. There's a mic coming.
I had probably association with you since 70s, and I recall that fierce young man.
You have to be brief, sir, because we're running out of time.
Okay. My question is, you have been always advocating innovation and technology for the industry, apart from good governance. How many times this issue came in Parliament, innovation and technology?
Thank you.
I mean, let's face it. Not too often. It did come in once in a while, but the private sector is not discussed too much, except something goes wrong and they want to hit the private sector, then it gets talked about. Otherwise, not much. So my brief answer will be, to save time, not too often. But I want to say one thing, which Tarun mentioned the very beginning. It's right to the extent the government, the politicians, and the press painted me like that. I agree. But the painting was not correct. But I told Indira Gandhi much earlier days, when she was alive, get Vespas and Hondas in. I would never have protection. In fact, he mentioned famously, now he's keeping quiet about it, a thing about cowboys.
This is the conversation with you.
I was not against the foreign capital. I was not about protectionism. What I said then, I've said every year since then, what I say today, and all the chairmen of all the large companies in America and Europe and Germany and everywhere say that. If at all, Israel may not be saying it as much. But everyone else does that, is I want a level playing field. Now, that is the only statement I made, and hundreds of times, that was taken as a euphemism for protectionism by people, I'm sorry to say, who don't understand economics or trade. Now the world is saying we want a level playing field. You have low labor cost. But Baba, if I have low labor cost, what about all the advantages you have? But that's another story. That's why they are becoming protectionists.
Yes, sir.
So good evening, sir. I'm a first generation entrepreneur. So what would you advise a first generation entrepreneur the core values they should maintain? Your success
formula. Sorry, say that again. What are the?
First generation entrepreneur. So.
Core values for a first generation entrepreneur. Not too many, just two or three.
First, the tough one. Yeah, I can give 10, 20, but
yeah,
I give
I know.
Three. Tough one, it's a tough one, and it's a, it's a bold thing. Integrity, honesty is the best policy. Short run, you may suffer a little bit, or not suffer, but you may not benefit. But in longer term, integrity is very important. Second, I mean, hard work, yes, is understood. Without hard work, I worked my backside off from 1965 till 2000. Some people say I still do that, but now it's very different. You have to work very hard. Whether you have it here or not, upar wale par. What is very important is, and the best way I can describe it, those people will understand who have seen that movie, Three Idiots.
Yeah.
Who have seen the movie Three Idiots? Do what you want to do. Do what is your passion. Do for something for which there's hunger in your belly. Today, everybody's top class in business. Everybody's MBA. You are brilliant. But you have to compete with not the others, you have to compete with the best in the world. And if you are doing engineering when you should be a photographer, you have no chance in hell. You must do, I don't know, by first, you can be a first generation entrepreneur in any field. You don't have to be manufacturing. Yeah. You can be in any field. You can set up a photography shop. You must love to do that. You must have passion to do that. And as I used to tell my children, you want to play tennis? Play tennis. Do what you want. But then be the best. Try to be the best in what you do. You want to play tennis, but you must at least play in Wimbledon if you don't win. You want to be a mountaineer? Be a mountaineer. But then you must climb Everest.
Hi, I'm Rajesh Sehgal from LIC. My question is, according to you, what do you think next 5-year life insurance industry future in India? And do you think that any private company has potential to compete with Life Insurance Corporation of India? Thank you.
I wish I can hear more seriously than that question. My son was here, he would give a much more accurate and better reply. I'm not running those two companies, which are joint ventures with Allianz. And if I do a little commercial here, in the private sector, there are over 20 life companies, there are over 20 general companies, we are amongst the top. There's some details, I won't go into them. We are amongst the top. Well, a lot depends how the next 5 years are for the life insurance company, because the new chairman of IRDA, whom I've never met, Insurance Regulatory Development Authority, happens to be, you know that, no? You are with LIC, no? Happens to be your former chairman, Mr. Vijayan. You know, he was chairman of MD, and you know there was a little complication. He is the chairman of that. Now, nobody knows the life insurance industry better than Mr. Vijayan. The major single problem, there are two questions you had asked about that. The major single problem of life insurance industry today is regulation. Not so much general insurance, but the life insurance. And if that doesn't take care of, the future for the life insurance industry is bad as a whole. Then because LIC is much bigger, it has 70-75% of the market, and it has all the assets and all that, obviously it will be better off. But till 2001, general insurance, life insurance, 100% business was public sector. Today in one of the two, 25% is private sector. And the other one is 35% is private sector in 12 years' time. It's not a joke, it's much major cost, much bigger, higher cost, much bigger thing. You had asked us two questions about that. How will it do? It will depend a lot on regulation. And what are they? Basically, it was that you had said in relation to LIC. Well, it depends. LIC has not only the strength of much bigger and, of course, the first mover advantage, but we are nimbler. We'd like to believe the private sector can be more efficient. Lot of our executives are former LIC people. If you didn't change, it's your problem from there to there. but that is in a lighter comment. So there's so much penetration required of insurance in India. There's such low penetration. I'm very positive, subject to proper regulation, for both life and general industry in India and for the private sector. Public sector will continue to do well. There's no reason. But we will not have any problems with that. Otherwise, lots of industries here would not have come up. In India at one time, it was all steel and all that. Barring Tatas, who was there in steel in private sector? Nobody. Sail and Tatas. Now you have Jindals and SRs and so many others. Anyway.
Last question. I know there are lots of hands up, but it's nearly quarter to seven, and he's got other commitments this evening. Yes, sir.
Good evening. I'm Ravinder Singh. I'm inventor. Sir, the banking credit has gone up by 6-7 times in last 10 years. But, you know, still the, you know, growth is going down. Sir, what kind of, you know, banking innovations you are going to introduce as a banker?
Innovations.
Banking innovations, you know, to banking. Make sure that, you know.
Banking?
I mean, you know,
I will not answer that question. Let's have some, because I'm not in the banking field.
Okay.
And if I get into the banking field, I don't even know whether I'll be chairman of that company or on the board of the company. My son and the team will look after it.
Thank you.
So I'm not the right person to answer. I'm sure chairman of State Bank will give you a much better answer.
Okay, we'll
or Chanda Kochar of ICICI.
Take a last question from you.
Sir, or Uday Kotak.
Sir, you have been an ideal businessman, and there's a lot of respect for your organization and your family and everything. But why you left the political field halfway? Because then we could have got another good leader in the political side. So that is a, you know, great...
Might still happen, you never know.
No, that's not something I can reply, but I appreciate the sentiment behind that question or that comment. And but I did say in the beginning, now right or wrong, many people have been telling me this. Many people have been telling me this, getting to politics. But I started by saying, I didn't join politics. In fact, Karan Thapar interviewed me after I came into the Raj Sabha. He said, you're a politician. He was talking to me the other day, but this was in 2006. I said, no, Prithvi, you are an MP. I said, so? Tell me a dictionary which says that an MP has to be a politician. I'm an industrialist. Everybody knows I'm an industrialist. I'm an independent MP. So, no, I don't have, you see, at the age of 75, and that time also, I'd say at the age of 70, I had no desire. If I had to go into politics, you have to go when you are in your 20s, 30s, or 40s. Okay, you have earned a little money. I mean, I'm talking to other people. I didn't need to do that. That before you get into politics, presuming you want to be honest, as you should presume, you must have your family set up and all that. Because in politics for a long time, you're not going to earn any money. To me, that was not an issue. But, okay, sounds big, but I wanted to be in industry. I wanted to create wealth for the nation, employment for the nation, in the process, wealth for my family and myself. Charity begins at home. And especially the way the last 10 years are going, or last 5 years are going, what do you do it? No one man can do anything. No one man can do anything. And I didn't want to break my head against a wall.
You don't want to stand? You're not going to...
Rahul Gandhi can do it. Yeah, I know what he did 4 days ago.
You're not going
No, he knows my son well. He knows me a little bit. I'm much older than him. His father appointed me chairman of Indian Airlines, 1986-89, and we used to meet quarterly. And then I said, no, he was called Ratan also. He used to call Ratan Tata, who was chairman of Air India. And so, and Jawaharlal Nehru and my grandfather, Jamnalal Bajaj, were considered, because of Gandhiji, they were considered brothers. Incidentally, both were born in 1889. Jawaharlal ji died in 64, my father died in 1942, very young. So we have very close connections in the family. And I'm against dynastic rule, one. Second, I would very much want Rahul, in spite of my first comment, to be the prime minister of this country, if he is going to be a competent prime minister of this country and take the country forward well. Otherwise, no. Whether he can be that or not, you should know better than me, Kalyani ji.
Okay, I think we need to stop here. Thank you very much, Rahul. We can continue for 4 hours. I think that was good. Thank you.